Hello and welcome to Newsfeed, your daily dose of what people are talking about online, from news stories to what's trending. If you're on Facebook or Insta, your feeds could get way more interesting. Love him or loathe him, the Donald is coming back. In what is being described as one of its most consequential decisions, Meta has announced that former US President Donald Trump will be allowed back on its platforms. Trump was kicked off Facebook and Instagram for what Meta described as praise for acts of violence. In his post during the January 2021 Capitol Hill riots, the then president commended the violent protesters. He also condemned former Vice President Mike Pence. Trump has already stated he will run in the 2024 US presidential election. Facebook, with its whopping 3 billion users, will certainly be a valuable platform to reach out to voters. You may remember from during his presidency, Trump was a prolific tweeter. But since he was banned from the platform after the Capitol riots, he's been using his own social media site. Truth Social has 5 million registered accounts, though how many of them are actually active isn't clear. Trump has yet to post on Facebook, though on Truth Social he wrote that Meta has lost millions in his absence, and that what happened to him should never happen to another sitting president. Meta says the decision to ban Trump was an extraordinary step taken under extraordinary circumstances. Here's how it justified it.
As a general rule, we don't want to get in the way of open debate on our platforms, especially in context of democratic elections. People should be able to hear what politicians are saying, good, bad, and ugly, to make informed choices at the ballot box. Now Trump's two-year suspension has elapsed. The question is whether the serious risk to public safety that existed in January 2021 has receded enough to allow the suspension to expire. To assess the risk, we evaluated current circumstances according to the crisis policy protocol established in response to AT Oversight Board's guidance, including looking at conduct of 2022 midterm and experts' assessments of security environments. We know any decision we make on this will be fiercely criticized. We try to make it as best we can consistent with our values and the process established in response to AT Oversight Board's guidance.
And we've heard reports for months now that Trump's aides have been lobbying Meta to reinstate his accounts. But his return could spell doom for Truth Social. Trump is locked into a contract with the platform that compels him to post there at least 6 hours before posting on any other social networking site. But the exclusivity deal comes to an end in June, and there's speculation he may not renew his contract. Meta says ahead of the elections, every politician should be allowed a platform to share their views. But with the number of Facebook subscribers dwindling, cynics believe Trump's return is a ploy to attract more users and bring in more money. Rights groups have expressed their fury at Meta, saying it won't be long before Trump starts spreading false claims again. But others believe that Trump's ban was unnecessary in the first place, as other world leaders have used social media to spread hate.
It didn't make much sense that the American president could be banned from Twitter, yet Muhammadu Buhari of Nigeria could incite genocidal slaughter against the Igbo and not get banned. In fact, no other world leader has been banned, including in Ethiopia with the Tigray. Modi in India has sent some social media messages, some tweets that are very, very much inciting. The Mataguri massacre, many people attribute that. So they haven't been banned. So it was a little peculiar that the American president would be banned by an American company, but not other world leaders. Well, as far as a precedent, let's please remember that while America enjoys the First Amendment freedom of speech, that's only as it relates to government intervention or government speech. Private individuals can censor each other how they wish. So I think the idea that there is a right to speak is a bit aberrant. They're pandering to a special interest, a perceived market, if you will, that was against Trump, a younger market. And certainly there were a number of congressmen, Democratic congressmen, that were putting a great deal of pressure to ban Trump. And I think the fruits of that have been shown to not be as desirable as the social media folks have wanted it. These people are in the business of making lots and lots and lots of money. They do things to make money. They want to say that they're there to serve, that they're there to shed light and to give information and hope and freedom. That's absolute nonsense. They're there to make tons and tons of money.
It turns out our favorite AI platform, ChatGPT, has the smarts to be a doctor, lawyer, or business exec. ChatGPT has passed the final exam for an MBA course at the prestigious Wharton Business School, as well as the U.S. Medical Licensing Exam and University Law Exams. But that's not to say that the text-based AI model is passing these tests with flying colors. In fact, professors say the AI platform is a mediocre student at best. Yikes. GPT-3, OpenAI's language model on which ChatGPT is built on, got a score of between B and B minus on test by Wharton professor Christian Turwich. He says it performs best at operations, management, and analysis, but is by no means perfect, making mistakes in simple math and more complex analysis. In University of Minnesota law exams, ChatGPT averages C+, well below humans' B+ average. That C+ would still be enough to earn the chatbot a law degree, although it would have been placed on academic probation at the Minnesota Uni. And in a Yale study, it got a passing grade in the U.S. Medical Licensing Exam. ChatGPT performed near or at the passing threshold for the three-part exam and demonstrated high levels of consistency in its explanations. It had not received any specific study materials or training before any of the tests. Our reporter Wilson has more insight.
Did your parents ever say, "Why don't you become a doctor or a businessman or a lawyer?" Well, now you've got an answer for them. ChatGPT can do all three things. It passed a bar exam, a medical licensing exam, and even a business exam at the University of Pennsylvania. Now, it didn't pass these exams with flying colors, but it was good enough. Researchers are realizing that people are worried about this taking over their jobs. But another thing we should be worried about is AI technologies are going to not have the kind of accountability that human beings have in these fields.
While ChatGPT has spurred fears that human jobs will soon become obsolete, the truth is AI has been in use for the past 70 years. AI tech has for decades been used in the workforce, commonly used to perform repetitive tasks at factories. It's also used in the tech sector to analyze information as well as optimize software, algorithms, and run programs like Amazon's Alexa or self-driving cars. The language model used in ChatGPT has actually been around for 30 years, but is only making headlines now after the chatbot was released to the public.
So in the simplest possible term, a language model is a statistical model that predicts the next word in a sequence of words. It's not a new thing. They were invented actually in the early 1990s, so decades ago. But of course, there's been a bit of a revolution in statistical models since then. So the early versions had very, very small neural networks. And since then, the neural networks have gotten bigger, they've gotten deeper. They've been trained on an insane amount of data. And of course, there's been this whole cloud computing revolution. So now we have insane amounts of compute power to train these models on lots of data.
It's trained on a large data set of curated written material. For instance, Wikipedia, all the books in the world, scientific papers, code, a lot of things like that. And it literally is trained by giving it a sentence, blanking out the last word and having it learn to guess what that last word will be.
Okay, you've got the gist of how ChatGPT is trained by going through mountains and mountains of data. Ask it a question and it'll answer within seconds. Let's see it in action.
GPT, I would like you to explain to me all about the use of chaos theory in predicting weather cycles. I'm not terribly bright, so I'd like you to explain it to me like I'm five. And if you wouldn't mind, could you give me the answer in exactly 10 bullet points? So, and it says, chaos theory is a mathematical theory that tells us that small changes in initial conditions can lead to large differences in the results. It goes on. This is used to explain how weather can be unpredictable, since small changes in the atmosphere can have large effects on the weather. Absolutely remarkable. So it's given us exactly 10 bullet points, and we asked it to explain it like we're five, and that's what it's done.
Twitter is back in the spotlight, but not for the right reasons. It's being sued by two groups who claim the social network failed to remove anti-Semitic posts. Hate Aid and the European Union of Jewish Students say that Twitter didn't remove six posts insulting Jewish people and denying the Holocaust. The lawsuit filed in a Berlin court will determine whether Twitter users have a legal right to enforce the company's terms and conditions. All of the examples of the hate speech mentioned in the case were posted in the last 3 months after Elon Musk acquired the social media company for $44 billion. There's been a lot of reaction online. Some have said they are concerned about Twitter's failure to enforce its terms and conditions and that the platform must be held accountable. The European Union of Jewish Students tweeted that they were suing Twitter for negligence over the hateful comments. And those at Hate Aid say that the posts are criminal and appalling, that they deny the Holocaust. Amazon workers around the world have been increasingly showing their anger at their poor pay and work conditions. Now, for the first time in the UK, workers have staged a walkout and gone on strike. It was at Amazon's massive depot in Coventry. While the GMB union only has 300 members from a total of 1,400-plus payroll, it brings to light the strict working practices demanded by the world's largest online retailer. Sarah delivers the story.
Amazon workers aren't as smiley as the Amazon logo. Now, they say that they're treated even worse than the company's robots and that when they go to the loo, their toilet breaks are timed. They're paid about $12 an hour, but they want $18.50 an hour. Amazon has said, no way. The most you can have is an extra 60 cents an hour. So, cue the strikes.
Absolute stars. Well done.
Stuart Richards is a senior union organiser and he posted this video of the moment the workers walked off the job. Support for the strikers then flooded social media. Ben Mitchell tweeted, I'm not the kind of person who blindly supports any strike, but this one I am 100% behind. Amazon are one of the scummiest employers around. Bobby Jaggs pointed out Amazon doesn't recognise trade unions in the UK and said this bullying should raise bigger alarm bells than it has. Vivi H won't be buying from Amazon and says it shouldn't do business in a country where it doesn't respect the labour laws. The Stop Shopping Choir UK came up with their own ditty to say they stand against billionaire greed. But Fraser has less sympathy, tweeting, who cares about timed toilet breaks? Surely only those who are swinging the lead. In other words, those who are purposely shirking off work. So, lots of noise on social media, but in actual reality, it's only one warehouse that these strikes are affecting and only 20% of the workers there have actually walked off the job. So, as far as Amazon's concerned, in terms of getting these delivered, it's business as usual.
Okay, so there's been a lot of criticism over Netflix's new reality competition, Squid Game: The Challenge. Critics say it misses the moral point of the original series. Well, The Challenge is in production in the UK now, and it started on the wrong foot, unfortunately. Day one saw on-set injuries during the infamous red light, green light game. The show features 456 contestants competing for a $4.56 million prize, with challenges inspired by Netflix's most popular series of all time, Squid Game, of course. But on day one of filming, three contestants required medical attention, with one of them being stretchered off set. Shot inside a former airplane hangar outside of London, temperatures fell to minus 3 degrees. When contestants started to feel unwell. Netflix says that claims of serious injury are untrue and that participants were prepared for the cold. However, some contestants say otherwise. One said that even if hypothermia kicked in, people were willing to stay for as long as possible because a lot of money was on the line. Too many were determined not to move, so they stood there for far too long. Another contestant says there were people arriving thinking they were going to be millionaires, but they left in tears. And that's our show. Find us on YouTube and do subscribe to our channel. Bye and see you same time tomorrow.